So, Stokes' formula general case. Again, suppose we have a surface. Now let me draw this surface like this, S. With this contour C. And this is the normal vector N. Let us do similar trick as we did previously when we proved the Green's formula. Let us cut this surface by some cut, by some segment of some curve. Yes? And consider two surfaces. Let me draw it again. And I draw like this. So, in fact, it is just one segment, but I a little bit move them apart to show that now we have two surfaces. It is S1, it is S2. And this is C1, this is C2. So C1, C2 is this, and here it moves in this direction. And C1 is like this, here it moves in this direction. So both contours are run counterclockwise. Yeah? We look a little bit from above. Now we have here the segment AB. Yeah? And let me call that as say MN. Yeah? So, and now let us consider the sum of contour integral around C1 and C2. So integral along C1 f dot dr plus integral over C2 f dot dr. No, integral over S1. It is integral along the curve BMA. Along the curve BMA. This. Plus integral along the segment AB. Now here, the second integral. Integral along the curve ANB. ANB. So along this part. Plus integral along the segment BA. But we know that integral along some segment, along any curve, finite piece of the curve, it is a segment, and integral along this segment with opposite orientation are opposite. So they have the same modulus, but opposite signs. Yes, to when you change the direction of your motion, the integral changes sign. Multiplied by minus 1. This means that integral along AB plus integral along BA is 0. And hence this is equal integral BMA plus, no, without a circle. And here, without circle, I'm sorry, because these are not closed curves, just pieces of closed curve. Yes, and now, yes, no, okay. So integral along BMA plus integral along A and B. A and B, this A. But integral along this curve plus integral along this curve is the same as integral along C, along the initial curve, yes? Equals integral along C of the same f dot dr. So integral along contour C is the sum of integral along contour C1 and along integral along contour C2. And integral over domain S, domain over surface S equals integral over S1 plus integral over S2. No, this is a universal property of integral. It is called additivity, that if you integrate over some domain and then you cut domain in two halves, then integral over domain is the sum of integrals over the halves of this domain. Yeah? So what does it mean? We want to prove that this integral our goal, prove that integral over C f dot dr equals integral over S curl f dot n ds. We want to prove this. And we, because of this additivity, we prove that if integral along C1, the same, f times dr equals integral over S1 of what written here, and integral along C2 equals integral over S2, if we have already proved this, then by the above was written here, integral along C equals integral over S. Yeah, because both left-hand side is additive and right-hand side is additive. So we reduced our problem to problems to two problems of the same sort. No, why is this halves better than why these halves are better than the whole surface? Yeah, why it is? What we gain? We gain the possibility to go on. So if we could cut it in two halves, then we can cut each half also in two halves and use the same proof to prove that the left-hand side, so it has, say, S1, S2, S3, S4, the contour is C1, C2, contour of this C3 and C4, we prove that some integral along C equals some integral along CN. No, in this case, n from 1 to n capital. No, n capital in this case 4, but then we can divide it further. Integral over d equal some integral along dn. Again, n from 1 to n. So we can further divide this surfaces, pieces of surface in smaller pieces, and then smaller and smaller and smaller, and after all we'll have the division in very small elementary pieces, elementary cells. So this is the surface S, and it is divided into many, many small pieces. Let me highlight one of them, say this piece, which is a piece S number I. And this piece is surrounded by the boundary. It is boundary curve, which is the curve CI. Yeah? And we know that integral over, sorry, integral along C F dot dr equals some integral along CI, I from 1 to n, f dot dr. And the integral over domain, over surface S, curl f dot n ds equals sum of integral over SI of the same I from 1 to n. Yes? And so if you manage to prove it for this small elements, small cells, they look like fish's scales. Yes, so they covered our surface by small scales. So if you prove it for each of this scale, then it is proved after, because of this formula, we have the Stokes theorem proved. So consider just one small piece. Let me draw this piece. It is a magnification of this piece. It is a piece SI, a piece of the surface SI. This is the contour CI. Let us choose here the point RI. So RI, a point with coordinate XI, YI, ZI. And now here we have the crucial moment. Our functions P, Q and R are assumed to be differentiable. If they are differentiable, or continuously differentiable, then in a small piece, small piece around the point ri, these functions are approximable by linear functions. Yeah, so let me write p of x, y, z, these coefficients of the vector field f equals p of ri. Ri it is x, y, y, I, z, I, plus dp dx at the point ri times x minus xi plus dp dy at the point ri y minus yi plus dp dz at the same point z minus zi. And let me write so it is approximately equal. Yes, I don't want to write here the remainder term and to estimate it. Yes, it is what I would do if I tell it to mathematics students. But at some to some degree, you should believe me, and I promise not to cheat you. So let me transform it a little bit. Transform means I want to write down here the constant. It is p of r I minus p x, I don't write r I, times x I, p x times x I, minus p y times y I, minus p z times z I, yes, plus p x at the point r I times x plus p y at the same point times y plus p z at the same point times z. No, I am not very interested in this constant. You will see that it after all is gives zero. So let me write it in the following equals pi bar. Pi bar, it is this. Pi bar plus px times x plus py times y plus, wait, let me write once. Px at the point ry I x plus py at the point ri y plus pz at the same point z. Yeah, so this way we write that near the point ri within this small piece si, the function p is approximately equal to some constant plus this linear function. And similarly, we write that q approximately equal qi bar, similar term, plus qx times x plus qy times y plus qz times z. And r approximately equal r bar plus r x x plus r y y plus r z times z. All these coefficients are derivative at the point ri, the center, say, of this small piece s I. Very good. And now let us evaluate the let us find the what I wanted to say, approximate what is the integral, yes, integral over ci of this p dx plus q dy plus r dz. Let us use this approximation. So we have to substitute here. First of all, it is p integral along ci. P equals pi bar plus px x plus py y plus pz z dx plus q bar plus q x x plus q y times y plus q z times z plus r bar plus r r I bar r x x plus r y y plus r z z. So here all these coefficients are constants. They we found in our approximation they are constants. Now here we can find some terms which will result in zero. First of all, integral over ci pi bar dx plus qi bar dy plus ri bar dz. It is constants, yes? So equals integral along ci. This is in fact gradient of a function. Dx of pi x bar dx plus dy of qi bar y plus dy plus dz of r I bar dz. So this is partial derivative of this linear function relative to x, and so integral it is a vector field equals I would say integral over ci gradient of the function pi x plus qi y plus ri z dot dr, which is zero, no, because it's potential field. And we integrate potential field along a closed curve. It is integral is zero. Now we have also other part which becomes zero. It is integral along CI PX X dx plus QY y dy plus r z z dz equals integral along ci. It is also the vector px qi y and r z z. It is a gradient of the following function p x times x square over 2, yes, plus q y square over 2 plus r z times z square over 2 dot dr. So if you take the gradient of this function, it's exactly the function, the derivative with respect to x is x times px, derivative by y it is qy times y, derivative of this by z it is rz times z. So it is again, we integrate a potential field along the curve ci, the result is zero. So not much remains in this long sum. So what remains? Okay, let me go here. So remains integral along CI PYY plus PZZ DX plus here Q X X plus R Z Z D Y plus R X X plus R y times y dz, integral of this. No, and so here I again say that all these coefficients are constants. They are partial derivative at the point xi, yi, zi, the center of this small piece. Now let me a little bit rearrange this. Equals integral P y dx plus PYY dx plus QXX QXX dy plus integral PZZ PZZ dx plus RXX dz. Plus integral, what remains, py, q, x, p, z, now q, x, it is q. QZ, so here dy, dx, dy, dx, dz, so remains dy, dz, QZ, z, plus QZ, z, dy, plus R Y Y D Z. So we have the sum of three integrals. So consider the first integral p y times y dz plus q x times x dy. Integral along ci equals integral along ci. The field p y y q x x one moment dy p y y dx QXX dy PYY QXX 0 dot DR. Yes, because here we have no DZ, so here it is 0. So this is this is a linear function. Yes, depending on linear function in y, simply constant times y. This function, linear function, constant times x. Yes, so and they do not depend on z. And here we have nothing, zero at the third place. So we have exactly the situation where we have proved the Stokes formula for this simple case, two-dimensional vector field. So by the 2D Stokes formula, this is equal to what? Integral over di of what? Integral si. Si of what? We have to take the derivative of this with respect to x. This constant, so it is just qx. qx minus derivative of this with respect to y, it is py. Integral over si of what curl of this vector field PYY QXX 0 dot N DS. We proved this formula. So we have already proved the true Stokes formula, but for simple simple vector fields, and here we have exactly this simple vector field. So by the same reason, the second term. We have the following. The field this PZZ PZZ zero RXX is two-dimensional. Yes, because this coefficient depends only on z, it is a linear function in z. This is zero, this depends only on x. Yes, so z and x enter here, and y does not enter. So it is a two-dimensional field in the xz plane, and so this means that integral over ci curl of pzz 0 rxx dot n d curl dot p z times z 0 r x x dot dr equals integral over s I curl of the same vector field p z z 0 r x x dot n ds. Yes. No, and the first. And the third integral ci q z z. It is the second and the third, so dy dz, so 0 qz times z ry times y times dr, yeah, dot dr. So this vector field depends on z and on y, yes, and its components are in z and y direction, and does not depend on x in no sense. This means that for this field we have already proved equals integral over si curl of this field 0 qz z ry y dot n ds. Yeah. So we proved for, and the sum of all other terms which enter in our vector field F, if you have true vector field F, so the constant terms which do not depend on anything, they give zero. There are three linear terms, they also give zero because the field made of them is also potential. So remains only this, and remains some small error because we approximated our vector field, we replaced it by linear field so that all coefficients or components of the field were linear functions. And it is we have some error both in the linear integral and in the area integral, and then we have some unpleasant work. Mathematicians like it, but normal people don't. To estimate these errors, they turn out to be very small when the size of the pieces goes to zero. These errors go to zero very fast, like some power of the size. And so in the limit, these errors disappear. And so this means that the Stokes formula is proved, approximately proved for a small piece Si with the curve contour Ci. Then we add them all together. We have the sum of this approximate linear integrals, line integrals in the left hand side, some approximate surface integral in the right hand side, and then we have to believe mathematicians that when the size goes to zero, the error both to the left and to the right goes to zero. If you take the sum and it goes to zero in the sum. If you believe it, then the theorem is proved. So again, the logical scheme of this proof is it consists of several steps. So one step, we proved this theorem, we derived it from the Green's formula for a simple case of two-dimensional vector field which does not depend on one variable, either x or y or z. Yes, then the second step, we reduced our problem by this cutting and eliminating some pieces of the for the line integral, they eliminate one another, that we reduced it to consideration of one small piece. Small scale or so, scale, I mean like a scale of the fish. Just imagine you have a big fish, it's covered by small scales. So we consider just one scale of this. We integrate some flux of the curl of vector field over through big fish. Yes, so we sum the surface of big fish. So we take the sum of integrals over this small scale. And then within a scale we approximate our function coefficients pq and r by linear functions. After this approximation, we see that some terms in the line integral disappeared, and what remains is the three terms which represent two-dimensional vector fields. Yes, so we integrate these vector fields around this circle and use the Green's formula or the previous lemma, I would say. Previous, we reduce it, the general case, to this particular case. That's it. I would say you that this derivation is not obvious even for mathematicians. So don't worry if you did not understand all details. I think this way is a classical way which was invented by classics like Maxwell, Kelvin, Stokes himself, yes, Green, Gauss. So it is the classical derivation. Yes, it has some advantage and some disadvantage. No, disadvantage that it stresses your imagination, and the advantage that I avoided long and tedious computations. No, it depends on what you like. So in my notes you will find this derivation. In the book you will find other derivation which is straightforward computation. I think two or three pages of integrals, and maybe you like it more. Next, what we will do, we will consider some applications, examples of these. You'll see how it works and how it plays. For now, let us finish. I think you have to breathe out. Have a good time. Bye.